my love, my lover, 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 I'm in paradise whenever I'm with you. My mind, well, it's a paradise whenever I'm with you. Ride on, well, I will ride on down the road, I will find you, I will hold you, I'll be there. It's long, well, it's a mighty long road, but I'll find you, I will hold you, and I'll be there.
From those other boys, but this time between, it's something that I feel it. I know you heard it from those other boys, but this time between, it's something that I feel it. If it feels like paradise running through your bloody veins, you know it's love anyway.
Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us for today's session of the Responsive Weekly. I'm so grateful that so many have chosen to join us this morning to talk about this really relevant issue. For those that didn't have a chance to actually read through the Responsive Weekly we sent out, I wanted to kind of set the stage prior to diving into this conversation. The Responsive Weekly is actually designed not to just be an email newsletter that Virtuous and our team here put together, but to really be a gathering place, a conversation starter, for those nonprofit leaders like yourselves and others that are trying to think differently about how they approach the fundraising task and really grow their nonprofit. And this week we talked just about that. We asked the question, what does thriving actually look like? And remember, this is going to be a discussion. So I would love to hear your feedback as we dive through some of these questions today. Unfortunately, I don't have my co-host, but we will have a co-host starting next week where we'll actually be trying to dialogue on some of these continued questions that we are asking. What now? How do we actually design and deliver fundraising programs for the rest of the year? 2020 has obviously been a year marked with uncertainty and many tragedies, but also it's been enlightening. And the constraints that 2020 has placed on us has actually made it really interesting to see how nonprofits have had to create through that. And so today we're going to be trying to answer this question, what now? But we're going to take it from a different angle because many nonprofits are struggling. And the question that I've been asked, and we were asked pretty significantly during the Responsive Nonprofit Summit 2 weeks ago was, okay, I get it. Like, I know organizations are being successful, but what does that actually look like? What does thriving look like? And so in this week's Responsive Weekly, we actually determined four key qualities. And these are different than last week. Last week, we talked about the three principles of a responsive nonprofit. These are complementary to that, but they're slightly different. And so the four things we're seeing as organizations who are thriving during this time is that they're experimenting bravely and embracing failure. They're asking big questions and taking bigger risks. And I want to pause here for a minute because in the Responsive Weekly this week, we linked to a panel discussion I had with Ryan Corey from St. Vincent de Paul here in Phoenix, where our headquarters are. And there was others on the panel, but Ryan said it really interestingly. He said, the thing is right now we're so focused on us as an industry. How are we going to reach our goals? How are we going to do this? What's our pivot plan? What does 2021 look like? We're asking these questions, but they're very much us-centered. And the thing that we're not doing is asking big questions with our donors. And so Ryan said, the way that we can begin to thrive is by, instead of coming to our donors with solutions, we just need to show up and ask big questions, because that invites donors to be a part of the solution creation process. So they're able to help imagine how they can be a part of some of the challenges that your organization is going through. And as Ryan pointed out, we can't even begin to realize those conversations with our supporters, especially major donors or larger funders, or even our everyday donors, until we stop asking questions about ourselves and begin to ask questions about our mission and surface those questions to our supporters. And so his charge was, we need to ask big questions. And then in summary on that same panel, whether it was Cameron or Maritza, or Cameron from the Exodus Road or Maritza from Preemptive Love, is they kind of echoed the same thing, but in a different way. We not only need to ask big questions, but we need to take bigger risks as nonprofit leaders. This year, 2020, is already kind of deemed, you know, an unfortunate year. And what that allows, and Maritza pointed this out, is how they're thinking at Preemptive Love, is that that gives us an opportunity, because failure is an option. Failure sometimes as nonprofit leaders, like, isn't an option. We have high expectations from our funders. Our mission depends on us every single day. And our donors are asking questions about where our funds are going and how they're allocated. But this year specifically, we have an opportunity to explore, because we're not being evaluated on efficiency in 2020. We're being evaluated on how well we can explore and seek out new opportunities in the market. And that requires you to take risks. The third thing we're seeing as what thriving looks like is, instead of trying to force a system on the supporters, we're letting donors determine next steps. And this is fundamental to responsive nonprofits. They lead with listening. And so instead of saying, okay, we need to run these campaigns and we need our supporters to do this and we need to do that, it's rather saying, what are we hearing from our supporters? What are the donor signals that we should be tuned into? And how can we respond to those in a way that allows us to more thoroughly connect our supporters to our story? That's what thriving looks like. And then the last thing that surfaced during this conversation a couple weeks ago was that, instead of trusting traditional broadcast-based fundraising tactics, organizations are using responsive fundraising strategies to really focus on this one specific thing, and that's to personalize every donor experience. Not personalize some donors' experience, but really think strategically on how we can personalize every donor's experience. That could be simply sending more personalized emails instead of sending this mass blast campaign that says, hey, give up now, we need your support in the next 60 days for year end. You might be sending a different email and saying, you know, I know someone on this panel or on that's participating is Jeff. And I could say, you know, hey, Jeff, you've partnered with us for years to help us provide children in impoverished communities access to education. In 2020, this has become even more important, but more difficult to deliver. And we know that we've partnered together to deliver this, but we need to continue the fight. We need to push forward. We need to make sure that we're thinking ahead and asking the bigger questions. We want you to be a part of that. And I could send that personal email as an organization that raises money for child development and invite Jeff, as someone who's already been committed to the mission and committed to the cause, to be a part of that as well and continue to invest together in helping provide children access to education. These are the types of ways that we can personalize every donor experience. And what we're seeing is organizations are taking this from a simplistic standpoint, like I just described, all the way up to doing this at scale, where they're not allowing the constraints of efficiency or process to prevent them from being personal with every donor. And so when a new donor comes on the file, instead of only personalizing the experience for those donors that have major gift potential because they've given $500 or more, or they have a D1 score or something like that from your wealth research, they're saying, no, we want to make sure that every donor, regardless, gets a personalized welcome. And that might be through email, that might be through mail, it might involve a phone call, but they're making sure that they don't take for granted every donor that comes on the file. And if we zoom back 6 months, and I would want to take a minute so you can kind of reorient yourself, because I know that's tough to even rewind back to March and April of this year. And remember what many were prescribing for organizations, whether they were small or large, was to lean on their donor base, to call them, ask how they're doing. Instead of doing things at scale, just going in and saying, you know, hey, we're gonna make some phone calls and we're gonna call our donors. Now, the thing that wasn't as obvious through that pledge was that you had to have a strong enough relationship with your donors that you had their information, you had the capacity to call them, they picked up your phone call. And so the organizations we're seeing thrive not only pivoted well through 2020, but they had also built the groundwork by personalizing donor relationships, not just for major donors or the top 10%, but but for all donors. And they respected that every donor mattered and that they were going to cultivate those relationships in a personalized way. That's responsive. That's what we're talking about in the Responsive Weekly, is how do we continue to have that mindset and do that well? So this was the big question for the week. What does thriving actually look like? But I'm curious for you all, like this idea of asking big questions or taking big risks. What questions are you asking your supporters right now as you head into year end? You know, we're post-election, but still in the midst of results. There's a lot of uncertainty as far as the relative kind of outcomes of that. But we know that there's still social unrest. There's division in our country. There's division in the world, even if you're not here locally. There's also a pending economic challenges, regardless of what the stock market says. There's this nuance throughout kind of financial reporting that there's something going on. There is going to be an impact because of the pandemic that happened in 2020 and the rolling results and impact of that, that we're going to see those challenges. So what are the big questions that you're asking as an organization? Feel free to share these in the chat pane, because I would love to hear from you. You know, what are some of the big questions you're asking right now? What are you asking individuals or supporters to partner with you on as you head into 2020, the rest of 2020 and into 2021? And what are some risks that you've taken? Maybe these were earlier in the year. Maybe these are things that you're thinking about over the next 60 days. Doesn't have to be fully thought out. Feel free to share some of those in the chat pane. I would love to hear from you all. And so I'm going to give you all a few minutes to share. I know I would love to hear from you, Ashley or Carol. David, thanks for being here. Heidi, Hillary, thanks for joining us. Hillary will be joining us in the future for as a co-host. So thanks for joining us as an attendee today, Hillary. Jeff, how are you all asking? You know, I know you help run a large operation at your nonprofit. Like, what are the questions you're asking? What are the risks that you're thinking about taking? How are you mitigating that as a team? Noreen, Sean, Susan, there's actually two Susans, so I'm, you know, calling out both of you. I'd love to hear from you. How are you all thinking about taking risks and asking bigger questions as you head throughout the rest of the year? Everyone's shy on this Thursday morning. Well, that's okay. I would love to still hear from you. Feel free to drop that in the chat pane. Oh, here comes all the feedback. So Sherry says, we're looking into how we can use more AI to better target our online fundraising, but concerned about perception from users. Can you, Sherry, what do you mean by AI? Is that for segmentation or to try to find donors that match your ideal donor profile, or to actually steward donors? Is it kind of an acquisition play or a stewardship play? And then why are you concerned? I'm curious if you've gotten feedback that would push back on using hyper-segmentation. Or has anyone else used AI? Maybe to help better target or segment acquisition campaigns or stewardship campaigns? Oh, Sherry, thank you for clarifying. So she said it's definitely for stewardship. So they're looking at using AI to reach back out to donors who have, for example, visited the website. Sherry, this is a great point of differentiation, because there is this kind of like industry term of AI, like artificial intelligence, and how that really is embedded in so much of our lives. Like even my, you know, cell phone this morning is using AI to determine what type of things or news that they should surface to me. I also think what you're referring to is something we call donor signals, Sherry, where you're using these insights around someone's involvement. So that might be the donor data or the history that you've had with that donor. The other is their interest. So like you mentioned, if someone visits your website, that's a donor signal of intent. There's some sort of curiosity that sparked them to land on your website. Your website is not like, a stall in a mall that someone happens upon. You know, they're probably coming to your website for some reason or another, and leveraging that in interest signal is something that we encourage our customers here at Virtuous to do very often. And we actually have the technology built into Virtuous to help you do that well. And so I think that there's an expectation as when you use donor signals to personalize experience, and it's in a helpful way, it's not in a creepy way, I think there's a lot of value there. One thing that I know we've done in the past when I was working at a nonprofit is if someone went through our donation process and failed to finish, we would follow back up with them and send them an email and say, hey, we saw that you began to initiate some sort of intent to make a donation. Did you have any trouble making the donation? And our assumption and our posture in that communication isn't trying to be creepy and say, hey, we saw you, we want to make sure you finish, but rather being helpful and saying, hey, we saw this happen. We're connecting with you in a personalized way. Maybe you got interrupted, maybe your kids needed something, or maybe you just like something actually broke, or there was a technology issue, or you had questions still that you didn't get answered through the donation process. So I think leaning in a posture of being helpful is no different than Netflix sending me documentary recommendations 3 days after I watch a documentary that mirror that intent. They knew that, they listened, and then they responded in a powerful way. And so that's the idea of interest signals. And I think leveraging those signals is a great way to be responsive, but to also cultivate donors in a more personalized way. I also think donors will tell you if they think it is creepy. And so you'll get that feedback and then just take that as what it is. But I think in bulk, when you have a helpful starting point, like our intent is to be helpful and personalize this experience, I think you'll be surprised by the results, Sherry. The last donor signal that I would just reference, because I do think it's relevant as well, is we talked about involvement, giving how they've been involved with your organization, interests, things like email clicks, the programs they've given to, the web pages they've visited, maybe the campaigns or events they've responded to. The last one is intent. So you have involvement, interest, and intent. Intent is much more difficult to gather outside of asking directly. And so this is a great opportunity for, I think, leveraging surveys to actually get feedback from supporters to help better steward them in the future or connect them to other programs that they might be more interested in. We might need to do a whole new responsive weekly on donor signals, because I do think it's a powerful conversation that we've had a few months ago on this within this community, but it's not something we've resurfaced in a while. So Sherry, thank you so much for bringing that up and for sharing your fears too. I think it is fearful sometimes to use this type of technology, but it's the spirit and the mindset I think that differentiates the result. Susan says, we've never really stewarded all donors with capitals, all. I have a plan to send an intro email to everyone after their first donation and keep communications going throughout the year. Susan, that's a great start. I think there's such a mindset in traditional fundraising teachings that we were actually taught to cultivate donors on a priority system based on their likelihood to move up the donor mountain or up the donor pyramid. And I think what we're seeing when we look at the data over the last decade is that those tactics, even if they're successfully cultivating major donors, has created a culture within fundraising organizations that are over-indexed on major donors, and they're missing kind of the pipeline of development to have a healthy donor base. And those organizations that don't have a healthy donor base obviously have extreme challenges when there are disruptions in the market, which whether it's a global pandemic, which is very unique and very different, or it's some other sort of crisis that happens every 18 to 36 months, you start to see those vulnerabilities revealed in those fundraising strategies. So Susan, I would commend you for taking the first step and saying, we haven't really looked at all our donors. And so how do we do that well? And I think sending an intro email to new donors is great. One thing I would encourage you, Susan, as you continue to expand this, is we did a recent research study with our friends over at Next After. And we found that cultivating donors through multiple channels increases their overall likelihood to give again by 3 times. So even if it's just an email and maybe a letter and or some other multi-channel cultivation, whether it's phone, email, phone mail, whatever's best for your supporters, and then even layering in additional channels, it can have a huge impact on your donor retention overall across the donor base. So definitely keep that in mind as you continue to build on what your first steps already are. Susan is from Teen Life, and she says, Arizona has removed youth suicide prevention from its medical priorities in 2021. So this is where the cause you're working on has decreased in priority for a supporting agency, meaning the organization will not be funding those programs going forward. This is a critical topic for our community and supporters. Susan, that's really tough. And I think those are the types of things that you should surface if you haven't already to your current supporters and your donor base. And I'm sure you at Teen Lifeline are doing that because it's such an important issue. But those are the types of challenges and problems I think we need to be more transparent and vulnerable with our supporters and begin to ask the questions, what can we do? And I think when I've stepped back and stopped over projecting and started listening and asking the right questions, that's when we actually found ways to improve our fundraising strategies. And so Susan, it sounds like you know, you're beginning those conversations because this is a huge pivot and challenge for you and your organization and the mission that you're serving. And so bringing supporters in on that and having discussion groups and other stakeholders might be a great idea. I might get the name wrong, but I think it's Lijo, says, we're really just sharing our story and adding more supporters to join our vision story, strengthening our supporter base. And Lijo, you hit on something that's crucial, is that when you strip away everything, the cause, all of us on this call in some capacity are responsible for bridging the gap between supporters and stakeholders in our story, which is our mission, our impact. And so not losing sight of that, even as we ask these questions and begin to evolve our strategies, is extremely important. And so Lijo, I think that's a great starting point in making sure that that's the foundation of what you're doing is critical. Sherry says she, this is going back to the AI question. She says, it feels a little stalkerish to be tracking them on the website and sending them info afterwards, but we're looking into it. And again, I think it's that balance and kind of making sure the spirit of what you're trying to do is be helpful and know that it's something I ran a major gift officer team for a little while. And we had a rep that was struggling with asking and just kind of this idea of like, how do I get new donor meetings? And it just feels awkward. Like I feel awkward with it. And I'm just really struggling on how to bridge that gap. And the thing that was revealing to me was something another advisor said to this, this major gift officer. And he was saying, you know, we have to enter conversations with the understanding that they want to do something. Like they wouldn't have given to support our organization if they didn't have a reason why. And so we shouldn't show up and talk to donors with a posture that they don't want to continue supporting or they don't want to deepen their engagement. If we start there, even if we're not expressing it verbally, our mindset is how do we turn this person around? Whereas the best fundraisers in this gentleman's opinion was saying are the ones that come in and know that they are helping to uncover or activate what this individual or this family or business or funder wants to do with their resources. And that's a huge difference that I think shows up in some of our fundraising appeals, even if we're sending it out to a large number of people, and how we posture in our strategies, whether it's one-on-one, one-to-many, you know, or one-to-most, and how we do that. I think the starting point though is the world we live in, as the founder of Save the Children says, is not ungenerous. They're just unimaginative and very busy. And it's our job as fundraisers to help make the facts known in a way that sparks the imagination of the world. And I think that is such a key quote to keep in mind as you push forward. So it looks like Christina said, hey, we're skipping Giving Tuesday. We're going to focus, or instead of fundraising on Giving Tuesday, we're going to focus on gratitude. To our donors, thank them for our continued support. Our staff and board members are going to make phone calls and write cards. That's a huge insight. I think sometimes it's great to go against that and say, hey, the best way to fundraise is to say thank you. And so, Christina, I commend you on that. It looks like Sherry's going to be doing the same thing. Diane says, last year we did a thank-a-thon, Christina, and it was a huge success. Just calling and say thank you, sending out cards for donor anniversaries and birthdays. I love the feedback that's going on right now because it's reminding me of the humanity of what we do as fundraisers, where it's just acknowledging other people and saying, we see you and we appreciate you and we know that you're a part of what we're doing, and continuing to cultivate that is so important. Susan says that they actually send thank you notes, newsletters, miscellaneous emails, but never just monthly emails or postcard thank yous or educational info. One thing this brings up is what we're seeing responsive nonprofits do that's counterintuitive to what maybe traditional fundraising practices say, is instead of crafting campaigns that say, you know, hey, on Giving Tuesday, we're gonna send out a thank you thon, do a thank you a thon, is that they're not doing time fixed campaigns that maybe are centered on gratitude, but rather dynamic campaigns. And we don't have a ton of time to unpack this because we do have to close up shop for this conversation this week in a couple minutes. But what that means is instead of saying, okay, well, on Giving Tuesday or on the month of November, we're gonna do a stewardship campaign, they're rather saying, what are the key milestones that donors go through? Maybe it's something as simple as the first year anniversary of their first gift to your organization, or when they started partnering with you as a supporter or as a volunteer. Or maybe it's when they get to $1,000 of contributions, or maybe it is their birthday or their actual anniversary as an individual, or some other milestone. So what are these key milestones in your donor's journey? And they're designing campaigns around the milestone and allowing those to run 365 days a year. And so when a donor actually achieves that milestone or activates that campaign then runs. And the great thing about this is that it doesn't have a fixed value either. It's not, hey, we did this in November and here was the results. It's rather we set this up and we're running this for year on end and we're generating results. And so instead of maybe having, you know, a 1 to 3x output from an input, you know, you can see 5 to 10 times the output based on the input. So it's something to keep in mind is, are there ways for us to create dynamic campaigns versus fixed campaigns, especially as you look to 2021? I've greatly appreciated all of the commentary on today. I think the biggest thing here, and I want to end on this, is we need to be asking these questions. We need to be thinking about how we can be taking, asking big questions to ourselves, to our board, to our stakeholders, and how we ask big questions to our supporters. And as we look ahead to 2021, we can't just resurface our 2019 fundraising plan that we brought to the table in December of 2020, or in January of 2020. We have to think differently about this. And the thing that we're seeing is those that are thriving are asking these questions, and they're moving away from this traditional strategy, and they're moving to being more responsive. And being responsive is a mindset. It's a posture towards your supporters that starts with listening and looks to cultivate relationships with all their supporters. So thanks everyone for being a part of this week's conversation. Until next week, have a great rest of this week, and I'll see you next Thursday right here at the same time. Thanks everyone.